Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So glad to see you all. I think the warming spring is beckoning some to enjoy the blessings of God's nature. We're glad for everyone, though, who's able to be here this morning. I'm going to make it really easy on you today. I have a greeting, either a Sabbath greeting or just a simple greeting in different languages from time to time. And I'm going to do this in honor of Peter today. So Peter cannot participate, but I'm doing this in honor of Peter's car. So it's so easy. You're going to get it even if you don't know Peter's car. But here it is. Guten Morgen. Everyone knows what that means, right? Anybody who doesn't know, Guten Morgen means in which language? German. Now, why do we dedicate that to Peter? Peter's not German, is he? Because he has a license plate from Germany. He has something. What is it on your car that's from Germany, Peter? It says what? Walnut? No, there's some German thing on your car. I'm going to go look, and I'm going to take a picture of it, and I'm going to come back here, and I'm going to prove it. Okay, even if I'm wrong, Peter, I still dedicate it to you because I love you. Okay, hey, we have an announcement to make. Praise the Lord that we are opening back up, right? And we praise the Lord that our numbers are increasing, and that means more fellowship of the saints. And that means we are able to transition our service a bit more. So, today, at the end of the message, we're going to show a video of a song. And we're not singing yet, but please feel free to meditate quietly and enjoy the beautiful, kind of like a second special music in a way, virtually. But next Sabbath, we're going to return to some amount of singing. And that means we're going to have an opening song, opening hymn, and we will have a closing hymn. And then what we're going to do, since we're just kind of want to do this in balance and careful as we ease back in, there's still concern with aerosols and things like that for some. So after the closing hymn, I'll have a benediction, and there will be a couple more praise songs. You can either stay after the benediction and join in the additional praise songs that will come at the end of the service after we pray, or you could choose to, that would be your time to leave. Either way, I'm going to leave after the benediction to greet people for those who are leaving. But if you'd like to stay and enjoy that music, please feel free to do so. We'll start that next Sabbath, and that's a good thing, right? Because that shows we're making progress here. And we praise the Lord for that. All right, please turn to chapter 1 of the book of Esther. Capitulo 1. Chapter 1 of the book of Esther. We're going to dive right in this morning at verse 1. Chapter 1, verse 1. Now in the days of Ahasuerus, who reigned from India to Ethiopia over 127 provinces. Stop there. This was the greatest empire ever known up to that time. Now, it doesn't sound like much as you read those few terse words, but if you look at the Persian Empire, it was amazing. Greatest empire up to that time in the known world, stretching on our modern maps from southern Pakistan, parts of Europe, into northern Sudan. It was the superpower of the day. So why does the author of the book start out this way? Well, the author definitely wants the reader to be impressed right from the start. And we're going to get more and more clues as to why that is. But first, for our historian lovers, a bit more speed dating. King Ahasuerus was born in 519 about 20 years after the death of Daniel. I think it helps to get context when you hear dates related to something. So he born just about 20 years after the death of Daniel, began his reign in 486 BC. The events of Esther begin around 483 BC, and the temple was completed just about 30 years before that. And Nehemiah will return to Jerusalem to finish what? What's he going to work on? The walls, right. About 15 years from the time of the story of Esther. Ahasuerus is a Persian title like Pharaoh for the Egypt. But still others knew him by Shahanshah, which means King of Kings. And if you think that's a mistake, just hold on, because we're going to learn more about that. Big implications. Xerxes is the Greek form of his name, and a lot easier to say. I keep tripping up over Ahasuerus. It is hazardous to say Ahasuerus. Okay, the king is located in the book of Esther in the winter palace, in the winter capital, in the palace of Susa, and the Persians would pronounce that Shushan. Sounds Chinese, doesn't it? And between what we find in the text, as well as what we glean from historians, we're tempted to think, let me give you this clue right now, between what we find in the text and what we glean from historians, we're tempted to think that if Xerxes didn't want to be a god, he at least wanted to be treated and worshiped like one. Does that give you a clue as to where we're headed? All right. The historian Herodotus adds to this by telling us his throne was always put far higher than anyone around him to create the impression that he was above the rest of humanity, like a god looking down on mere mortals. And this idea was reinforced by his 14,000 strong elite group of bodyguards. Imagine having our president, having 14,000, needing that many bodyguards, your own secret service. But guess what they were called? The immortals. Again, you know, this hearkening to divinity, to deity, the immortals. And they would build a platform on the highest accessible hill so the king could see everything and everyone could see the king elevated high above them. That was important for Xerxes to have that vantage point. Now, if anyone were to touch the throne, what would happen? Immediate what? Immediate death. If you even touched the rug that lay under the throne, death. You were even required to bow before the throne in worship and adoration, even if the king wasn't seated there at the time. Do not dare to pass by that empty throne without bowing and worshiping. So, while what's missing in Esther is in an acknowledgement of God, what's present is one who wants to be feared as God. Are you with me? That's what we're going to build on this morning. Now, let me ask you this, though. We already gave you a clue last week that Esther raises a lot of questions within the book, and here's one to start us out. How do you think this kind of Messiah complex that Xerxes had going on, how do you think this would challenge the faith of the Jews still living in his kingdom? Now, while the Jews clearly wouldn't see Xerxes as a god, they might see him as having the blessing of the gods because of his vast wealth and power, and that could be confusing. Why? Why would that be so confusing? Because Lord, the Jewish person could pray. I thought we were supposed to be the head and not the tail. I thought we were supposed to be the most prosperous nation on the earth, yet aside from the temple, Jerusalem still lay in ruins. So Lord, either perhaps you don't exist, or maybe you're not strong enough to deliver on your promises. Do you see how tempting it could be to judge solely on outward appearances? We talked a lot about that in our last few sermons. But that's why we remember our quote from last week. All that we see is not all there is to be seen with God. Amen? God is always working behind the scenes. He has a plan. He's in control. So do not focus. That's why we said we do not focus on the physical world below the line, we focus on that invisible but eternal realm above the line where God dwells and he's able to communicate to us from there. All right, let's focus now on what Xerxes loves best: wine, women, and bling. All right? Wine, women, and bling. Verse 4 tells us he's going to throw the greatest hootenanny of all time. How many of you know what a hootenanny is? All right, hootenanny is a good Persian word, obviously southern Persia. Talk to me later, I'll explain that. This party's going to be huge, and the party's going to be huge. 180-day marathon of music and munchies. Can you believe that? 180 days, that's 6 months, right? 180-day party. And according to verse 3, who's invited? Military leaders, princes, and nobles, kind of the elite. But wait a sec. Maybe a bit of R&R was just a cover story. Because if you research the timeline, he may have been pumping up the military leaders for his next attack against the Greeks and what would turn out to be the famous battle of the 300 Spartans. You've probably read about them or seen movies about them. But in that war, Xerxes was eventually defeated by the navy. It was a great loss for the Persians, but that war takes place between the six-month party and the time when Xerxes begins searching for a new wife. Not explicitly stated in the chapter, but that's when that war takes place. Now, verse 4 says the real reason for the massive shindig, that's another good Persian word, was to show them the riches of his royal glory and the splendor and pomp of his greatness. When's the last time you or I threw a party to display the splendor of our riches, glory, and greatness? I don't know the last time I got an invitation to a party like that. If social media had existed at that time, his Twitter account would have blown up with things like hashtag greatest party ever. You will be attending, won't you? Hashtag who's Tom Brady? I'm the goat of the entire planet, so come see the riches of a true winner. And once inside the palace, the glimmer of diamonds and rubies would have stunned the eyes. The property brothers would be impressed. Chip and Joanna would have said, nothing more to do here. The narrator describes the scene with exquisite detail. Fine linen curtains attached to silver rods, marble pillars, polished flooring, couches of gold and silver. Get this, golden goblets, golden drinking goblets, not a single one alike. No match sets, Not a single one alike. Only Solomon's temple is described in as much glorious detail. But let's pause for a sec. Ever carry around a false identity? I think many of us have without knowing it. Here's one of them. I am what I have. I am what I have. Some base their identity on what they possess or what they lack. But God's children get their identity from who they are in Christ, not from their credit card limits. Amen? That's how we get our identity. So where are you and I getting our identity from? From our wealth, our riches, our possessions, like the king, or from Jesus? In 2014, a sinkhole opened up under the National Corvette Museum in Bowling Green, Kentucky. Any of you remember that? It was in the news for quite a while. And now there's a sign after they made the repairs pointing to where 8 Corvettes in their collection got swallowed up by the sinkhole. But someone said they should add a bit more to the sign. They think it should read, "The sinkhole got 8 of our cars, but one day they will all be gone." Isn't that true? One day they will all be gone. And that's why the Apostle John says everything we can taste, touch, and see, the lust of the eyes and pride of life, is not from the Father, but of the what? Of the world. But the world is passing away. And that's why he says they will all be gone. All those things we get our identity from here on this earth, those pleasures, those possessions, they'll all be gone. But the one who does the will of God remains for how long? Not 180 days, but forever and ever. Praise the Lord for that. All right. Now, going on in verse 8, we move from drapes to drinks and to an unusual decree. You see, it was Persian party protocol to drink as much as the king's servants put before you. If the king had his servants bring out 5 gallons, you better drink that 5 gallons up. In fact, that was such a strong belief that even the designated chariot driver for the evening couldn't get out of it, all right? But in a surprise move, the king waives that requirement, essentially saying, however much you drink, it's up to you. I'm going to be gracious tonight. I'm going to relax this rule. Maybe the king was trying to cut cost because of the 6-month bar tab. But despite the gracious gesture, it only served to remind the Jews that every single detail of life was in the hands of the king, for better or for worse. And we saw earlier how tyrannical he could be if you didn't obey his rules to the exact letter. So here's an honest question. Why didn't those Jews leave 50 years before? The door was still open, so why not load up the U-Haul and get out of there, make a run for it today? Why stay? I've got to tell you that a lot of commentators build a very negative case about the Jews who remain behind. Many of them say things like, well, those who stayed likely tended to lean towards secularism. They had a very secular view of faith. Now, if that assumption is true, they're saying that those who stayed behind basically wanted, well, enough of God to save them if they got in trouble, but not enough to make him a part of their everyday life. Does that sound familiar? Enough of God to save me if I'm in trouble, but not enough to make him a part of everyday life, because that's what the Jews would be expected to do back in Jerusalem, and they didn't want to take their faith that seriously. Well, I'll call on God when I need him, but to have him as the focus and center of my everyday life, I'm not up for that. So staying in Persia gave them some, what shall we call it, breathing room, some spiritual breathing room. Well, that's according to the view of some commentators. Well, quite a lot of them. But I want to ask you something. Is that the only possibility? I don't think that's the only one. Remember we said Nehemiah would be there for another 15 years? Would you describe him as lacking in faith? Not at all. So, another possibility. Maybe some were too elderly, feeble, or ill to make the trip home. And family members didn't want to leave these vulnerable ones behind, so they stayed to take care of them. So there are other possibilities, aren't there? All right, but here's the problem. True believers or not, the Jews had unavoidable choices to make under this godless king. Do I give in and compromise to save my skin, or do I obey God alone, no matter the consequences? You're invited to the party. Do you come? You're invited to get drunk with the rest. Do you drink? You're invited to a beauty pageant. You're invited to spend a night with the king. What do you do? Will you save your skin? Will you choose another way? Or is God going to work in and amidst our choices that we have to struggle with? Those are hard questions, aren't they? And you know what? Not a single one of us has a definitive, clear, or right answer because we don't have enough information. We don't know. God didn't appoint us to be judge over that. But those are questions that they had to wrestle with. Any good Jew would have had to have wrestled with those questions and figure out their own answers. And today, aren't we faced with choices and consequences and things we have to wrestle with? We may not live in a totalitarian state like they did, but we have choices in life. Are we going to save our skin? Are we going to look out for us and our comfort? Or are we going to give God the glory that he deserves, the worship, the loyalty, and allegiance that he alone deserves? Here's the marvelous thing about God. We've raised that question, but here's something struck me, so I put it in and I thought, wow, this is beautiful. Later on, when the Jews are threatened with extinction, the Lord doesn't base his intervention on whose motives were perfect and whose weren't. Isn't that great news? He doesn't base his intervention on that. He doesn't separate them out. All right, I'm only going to save those who stayed here for the right reasons. All the ones with pure motives, you come to my right, you're going to be saved. Those of you whose motives weren't so pure, you stay off over there until the time for your destruction. No, not at all. Instead, God will deliver all the Jews when the time is right, and he doesn't make a distinction between whose motives were pure or purest. Isn't that great news? And that's reflective of the gospel. For God did not send his son to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be what? Might be saved. And remember, what's always in the background but not explicitly stated in the book. We brought this up. Satan's plan since Genesis 3 has been to what? Does anybody remember? To wipe out who? Wipe out God's people. Remember? Wipe out the woman, the church. In order to what? Stop someone. Stop who? If you stop the woman, then you stop the coming forth of who? The Messiah. Stop the woman, you stop the coming forth of the Messiah, the woman being the church, because the Messiah would do what to the serpent? Crush his head. You will bruise his heel, serpent, but the Messiah will crush your head. He will put an end to you. So since Genesis 3, Satan's number one plan has been to stop God's people, at the beginning, the Jews, from the Messiah's being born among them. That was his plan. What does that mean? What are the implications? The stakes are so huge in the book of Esther, because if Haman had his way, he wouldn't have only destroyed the Jews living in Persia, but those who had returned to Jerusalem as well. And so Satan was trying to inspire the destruction of the Jews to stop the Messiah. Do you see how important? People say, well, Martin Luther, in fact, wanted to throw the book of Esther out of the Bible. John Calvin wouldn't preach from it. He said, there's no Jesus, there's no gospel. Folks, I'm not better than Martin Luther, but I will say this. I believe that the gospel is subtly woven throughout the entire book. Because if God's people are wiped out, then there's no Messiah to come forth from among them. And that's huge. That's the gospel. No God's people, no Messiah, no Jesus, no hope, no salvation. So talk about how clearly the gospel is so prominent in the background. I think it's huge. All right? So even though Martin Luther wanted to throw it out, the truth is Jesus and the gospel has everything to do with this book. Before I began studying Esther and preparing for this message, do you know what I thought Esther was about? I thought Esther was primarily about a courageous woman who saved the exiled Jews from destruction. Now, is that accurate? That is all accurate, right? A courageous woman did help save the exiled Jews from destruction. Although, if you think about it, maybe it's not fair to call them exiles, because they technically weren't exiles anymore. They could have gone back. Regardless, I don't think that's the main, that's the outward presentation of the book. You know what I really think it's about now? It's about preserving the promise of the gospel. Because if God's people are wiped out, there's no Messiah and there's no gospel. So now I believe Esther is much more about the gospel than it is about just saving Jewish exiles. It's about preserving the promise of the gospel. So now I see the gospel as entirely prominent throughout the book. All right, now back in chapter 1 to our six-month party, it goes so well that they tack on another 7 days, and this time they invite the more common folk in from the city. And the women, the queen and the women, the wives of all these people, have been having their own fiesta as well. But now notice how sevens keep appearing as we go along. On the seventh day of the seven-day feast, verse 10 says, the king is drunk, right? What's verse 10 say? The king is really sloused, right? No. We tend to infer that. It simply says, depending on your translation, he was in high spirits or merry. In other words, he drank enough perhaps to be in a really good mood, but he wasn't plastered. There's another Hebrew word for that, which they do use in the chapter, but it wasn't applied to him, all right? Now, he was in a good mood, high spirits, and then he commands how many of his servants to get his wife, the queen? Seven, another seven. And what's her name, by the way? Remember her name? Vashti? And scholars aren't certain what her name means. They say it possibly means best, the beloved, or the desired one. Well, she comes out with a nice name, no matter how you look at it. Now, in any case, the king wants to show off his prized possession. But if you've been catching the narrator's little subtle signals, you get the idea about this guy. The real purpose isn't to honor her. It's more of a statement about him, isn't it? What a desirable, wonderful person I must be to have the most beautiful woman in the kingdom as my wife. See how he turns that around? It's narcissistic. It's all about him. How I'm going to show off my most prized possession. Why? Well, really, guys, think about it. If she married me, I must be the most desirable guy in the kingdom. All right? Now, here comes another pesky question. Why did he call for her? Why? Now, remember, careful about assumptions that aren't in the text. Did the king ask her to dance before them? No. Did he ask her to immodestly traipse down a fashion runway? That's what most commentators say, without going into detail. But many scholars are convinced the king had impure intentions. But just going by the text, I can't go further than that because that's all that's there. All she was commanded to do was appear while making sure to wear her what? Her royal crown. That's all the text says. But then come the fateful words in verse 12. Queen Vashti refused to come at the king's command. Now the narrator wants this to come as a shock to us. And it does. After that long and lavish 187-day display, the king doesn't look nearly as powerful as he did before. Because the king who rules the greatest empire in the world can't even control who? His own wife. Wow. You can imagine the huge embarrassment and humiliation. So how do you think he took it? Well, I'll describe it this way. If you had given him a mood chart at that moment, he probably dropped a couple of levels from being merry to, I'm so angry, I just want to floss my teeth with barbed wire. It's about how he felt at that time. Actually, we don't have to guess, because verse 12 says, at this the king became enraged, and his anger burned within him. Now, let me clue you in. The king is obviously about to overreact. But why? Because of his pride. He's about to overreact because of pride. He's horrified at what his people will think of him. He's horrified at what his people will think of him more than he cares about the welfare of his wife, right? She's just been humiliated herself. She's been put on the stage. She knows the consequences. She's in a terrible spot, but he cares more about what people think of him than for the welfare of his wife. Pit stop for another quick question. Was he wrong to summon her? Was he wrong? Now, these are just opinions. I understand. We all don't know, but opinions are free, all right? So there's no penalty for having an opinion. That's okay. How many think he was wrong to summon her? I would lean toward that direction myself. But it's just an opinion. How many think she was wrong not to come? It's just an opinion. Their case could be made either way. Well, the problem is, again, we don't have all the information, but I think we do have something. And from where I stand, I'll go out on a limb with just an opinion. Even though the king wasn't drunk, you've got thousands, scholars think as many as 15,000 or more, inside the palace who clearly are. And now, what kind of husband would call for a woman in this very patriarchal society where women are protected and they wear the veil and they're very careful about things? What kind of husband would call out his wife to be the centerpiece of thousands of drunk men? I think that says something. But so while she broke protocol, she also sought to protect herself because the king wasn't doing that for her. That wasn't the king's interest. So she broke protocol to protect herself. And at that moment, before things explode and there's this huge overreaction, imagine if he had privately taken her aside and humbly apologized, seeking to make peace with her. How beautiful that might have gone. We just don't know. But what stopped him? Pride wouldn't let him do it. Instead, he turns to a specific number of advisors, and I bet you can guess how many he turns to. Again, siete, seven. Again, seven. 7 days of feasting, seven special servants or eunuchs, seven trusted advisors. Some scholars say it's meaningless, coincidental, nothing to it. But others say the recurrence of the number seven in a book focused on God's Jewish people, right? It's too obvious to dismiss. Seven is whose number? God's number. So I believe it's likely a subtle reminder that God's presence is in the events taking place, even though he seems so hidden from our view. Isn't that beautiful? In other words, God sends his special number like an ambassador to assure us that he's there. Isn't that beautiful? The number of seven is like God's ambassador to assure us that he's there. I like that. So back to the seven advisors, what do they say? Well, we already know what they're going to say. We know they're going to base their counsel on whatever the king wants to hear, right? If you're smart, if you want to live another day, whatever the king wants to hear. So if it appeared to them the king wants to be gracious and forgive the king, well, they'd back him up. But if he didn't, she was toast. So, however, the king's signals are clear. So his counselors will be sure to make the king's anger and punishment look reasonable and justified. Folks, pride is so destructive because you know what it does? It protects ourselves at any cost, leaving us willing to diminish others at any cost. That's what pride, that's why we overreact, because we want to protect ourselves at any cost. And this is why the king overreacts, to cover up his own guilt, his own need of repentance, by deflecting, by putting the blame on someone else. She disobeyed the proper protocol, so the king's anger and punishment is totally justified. But you know the problem with that? The king's overreaction turns a marriage issue into a matter of national security. The king gathers these seven men who understand the times, that's astrology, as well as legal matters. And the funny thing is, their spokesman, Memucan, didn't mention the law at all. So in verse 16, the guy doing a bad Persian Perry Mason impression says, Not only against the king has Queen Vashti done wrong, but against all the officials and all the people and all the provinces of the king. For the queen's behavior will be made known to all women, causing them to look at their husbands with contempt. You talk about overreaction. You know what this advisor is saying? He thinks Vashti's refusal could threaten the very fabric of society. If something drastic isn't done soon, no wife will listen to her husband ever again. Doesn't that sound like a bit of a stretch to you? However, and he says in verse 19, let a royal order go out. Let it be written among the laws of the Persians and the Medes. What is the law of the Persians and the Medes? Once you make a law, it what? Cannot be repealed, right? Can't go back on it. Vashti is never again to come before the king, and let the king give her a royal position, this hurts, to another who is better than she. Ouch. And when the decree made by the king is proclaimed, all women will give honor to their husbands, high and low alike. Folks, you know there's something fishy here. First of all, Memucan says he's afraid everyone will hear about this, yet then they make a law causing everyone to hear about it for sure. It's ridiculous. You see through this stuff when people act so righteous and justified. You just see through these things. Secondly, Vashti's punishment is what? Not being able to see the king? But that's apparently what she wanted in the first place. She didn't want to see the king. It sounds like their marriage was on the rocks for some time. We have some clues for that. Finally, Memucan thinks he can force wives to respect and love their husbands. Ladies, does that sound like a good law? A good decree? Well, I'd like to offer a motion and see what man will second it, that we enforce all the women to, right? This is ridiculous. Anger, threat, and punishment is the way of those who fear the loss of their control. But humility and love is the way of those who trust God for His control. For Christians, it's not about clinging to control at any cost to others. It's about loosening our hold and giving God control at any cost to ourselves. We're willing to let go at any cost to ourselves. I want to close this morning by thinking of the larger gospel view hidden within the story. Already we could see this. The king calling for his bride to come to a feast reminds us of a bigger story about a greater king who called his beloved bride to a feast. Xerxes' servants called the bride on behalf of the king, but King Jesus left heaven to invite his bride himself. Amen. He wanted us even when we did not want him. He sought us even when we were not seeking him. For just one rejection of the king's authority, Vashti was forever banished from the king's presence. But our king atones for our many sins and brings us into his presence forever. Hallelujah. Something to celebrate. We don't have to be like Vashti because her king is nothing like our king. While Xerxes threw a feast for prominent servants, King Jesus throws his feast for pardoned sinners. And the sweetest prize of the gospel is not that we get the feast, but that we get the king himself. Won't you accept the invitation to the feast today. You know, as we go through the book of Esther and we look at all the play and counterplay and all the dark foreboding threats, and already dark things are happening, who's still in charge? Our Heavenly Father. This is my Father's world. Let's take a few moments to enjoy that hymn, and then we'll have our benediction.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my
Oh, Father, I can't believe it, but it's there. Even in the midst of the dark, foreboding chapter, there is the promise of a gospel that cannot be stopped. I'm so glad for that, Father. Already we have a clue. Already we see that no matter how much the enemy rages against your people as a whole or us individually, he cannot conquer because our King is stronger. Greater is he who is in us than he that is in the world. Continue to give us gospel-filtered eyes. Well, we can filter everything through the eyes of the gospel, and that way we'll always see the hope. We'll always see the promise that's there. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.